Learn Computer Science on the Go. Written by Austin Mulka. Directed by John Burra. Narrated by Duke Holm. Edited by Alex Kropf. Produced by LearnOnTheGo.io and Mammoth Interactive. All rights reserved. This audiobook was designed for you to learn as much as you could on the go. For more audiobooks, visit LearnOnTheGo.io. Try hands-on coding with a free video course. Visit MammothInteractive.com now. Chapter 1. Introduction to Computer Science. Section 1. Introduction. Learning a new skill can be scary and overwhelming. If you're reading this book, chances are you've tried to learn about computer science and programming before. When I first started learning about computer science, I knew a bit about computers and tech, but I still had a hard time understanding a lot of the videos, articles, and books on the subject. It's totally fine if you don't get something, like a concept, a section, or even a whole chapter. There will be times when you just don't get it, and that's okay. It doesn't mean you can't learn or that you should stop trying to learn. Sometimes, you might read something and think you understand it, but when you try to use it in your projects, it doesn't work out. Think of it like when you first learned to ride a bike. You got the idea, but it took a few tries before you could ride without falling. If you are a complete beginner to computer science, you are going to come across a lot of unfamiliar words and phrases, as well as technical terms. At times, it may even feel as if you're reading in a different language. This is completely normal, and no reason to feel scared or intimidated. Think back to a time when mathematics felt like a foreign language. Remember the first time you encountered words like division, addition, subtraction, or even the concept of numbers themselves? These terms, once confusing and perhaps intimidating, are now secondhand in your understanding of the world. Imagine trying to understand a math problem without knowing the basic operations. It would be puzzling, right? The same goes for computer science. Understanding its basic concepts, like what a loop is in programming or what data structure means, is like understanding addition and subtraction in math. Once these foundational elements are clear, a whole new world of understanding opens up. Terms like algorithms, programming, and binary code might seem confusing at first, just like multiplication or fraction might have seemed in your early math classes. So don't worry if things seem hard at first. It's all part of the learning process. Just like riding a bike, with practice and patience, you'll get better at computer science and programming. Keep going, and you'll make progress. Section 2. What is computer science? Computers can do many things, from simple math problems like what you use a calculator for, to really tough jobs, like running big programs that can mimic a human brain. Computers are super important in our lives today because they help make a lot of things work, like cell phones, the internet, scientific research, and keeping track of money. At the core of computer science is solving problems. They do this by making algorithms, which are like recipes that computers follow to get a job done. Computer science really depends on these algorithms, like blueprints that guide how to build programs and computer systems. These algorithms are like handy tools that make software and electronic systems work faster, more accurately, and better in different kinds of jobs. Computer science also digs into big questions about what computers can do and how they do it, which is called computation theory. It's all about figuring out the limits of what a problem-solving recipe can do, what's impossible for it to do, and how well it can do its job. This big-picture thinking is what they use to come up with new ideas and gadgets in computers. Another big part of computer science is creating software, which involves making the programs that computers run. Making software is creative. It's not just about writing secret computer language. It's about finding new ways to solve problems and making sure the programs can handle whatever people need from them. This section will give you a very broad overview of computer science, programming, and what we will be discussing throughout this book. Because of that, there is going to be a lot of new vocabulary and concepts mentioned in the next few pages. If you feel lost or confused, don't worry. This chapter is to give you a general brief instruction to these keywords and principles. We will be covering these topics one at a time and in much more detail in the next chapters. Computer science is the study of computation and its applications. Computation refers to the process of carrying out calculations or applying algorithms to manipulate and process data to achieve a desired output. Input. This refers to the data or information that serves as the starting point for a computational process. Output. The result or outcome of the computation process, which may take various forms such as numbers, information pieces, visual displays, or any other relevant output format. Algorithm. It encompasses a sequence of step-by-step instructions or rules that dictate how the input data should be manipulated and processed to generate an output. These algorithms are often represented using pseudocode, flowcharts, or programming languages. Processing. This stage involves executing the algorithm on a computational device, such as a computer, calculator, or even the human brain. During this phase, the input data is transformed based on the instructions laid out by the algorithm. Memory decodes the fetched instruction, interprets it, and sends control signals to input-output devices. Data structure. A collection of data values that includes operations that can be applied to that data. Variables. Used to store information that can be stored and manipulated in a computer program. Conditionals. Used to perform tasks, such as repeating an operation a number of times before the program can continue. Looping. Used to perform tasks, such as repeating an operation a number of times before the program can continue. Section 3. A Brief History of Computers. The journey of computers from colossal machines filling entire rooms to sleek handheld devices encapsulates one of the most rapid evolutions of technology in human history. This journey has redefined how humans communicate, work, and play. The mechanical beginnings. 17th century. The concept of a computer begins with mechanical inventions like the abacus and continues with more sophisticated devices like Blaise Pascal's Pascaline and Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz's stepped Regen in the 17th century. Mechanical calculators capable of performing basic mathematical operations. The analytical engine and the concept of programmability. 19th century. Charles Babbage, an English mathematician, conceived the analytical engine, a steam-powered calculating machine that used punch cards for input and could perform not just calculations, but also make decisions based on previous calculations, laying the groundwork for programmable computers. The electromechanical era. Early 20th century. The transition from mechanical to electromechanical devices starts. Machines like the Harvard Mark I, designed by Howard Aiken, and IBM in 1944, could do long sequences of calculations automatically. The Electronic Revolution, 1940s. The development of electronic computers began with machines like the ENIAC, or Electronic Numerical Integrator and Computer, which used vacuum tubes to perform calculations. It was massive in size and energy consumption, but exponentially faster than its mechanical predecessors. The era of transistors and microprocessors, 1950s to 1960s. The invention of the transistor and, later, the integrated circuit, or IC, significantly reduced the size and power requirements of computers. In the 1970s, the microprocessor, essentially an entire CPU on a single chip, revolutionized the feasibility of personal computers. The birth of the personal computer, 1970s to 1980s. With the advent of microprocessors, companies like Apple, IBM, and Microsoft emerged, leading the wave of the personal computing revolution with user-friendly devices and operating systems. The Internet Age. The 1990s to 2000s. Computers increasingly become connected through the growing web of the Internet. Email, global networking, and the World Wide Web transform computers from computation devices into essential tools for communication and information. Portable computing and the mobile revolution. 2000s to present. The rise of laptops, smartphones, and tablets makes computing power even more accessible and portable. The concept of computing goes beyond the traditional boundaries, with smart devices becoming ubiquitous in everyday life. From the abacus to artificial intelligence, the history of computers is a testament to human ingenuity and an ongoing quest for advancement. As we look toward the future, it is evident that the next chapters of computer history will continue to shape the fabric of our society in ways we are only beginning to imagine. Section 4. The significance of computer science in the modern era. In today's world, where technology plays a big role, the importance of computer science in our daily lives is huge. This area touches many parts of our day-to-day life, changing industries in different fields of science. It's seen in how smoothly our smartphones work, the big changes in healthcare, and the continuous improvement of many industries. Our smartphones, which we use all the time, show just how far computer science has come. They are a mix of software and hardware engineering, showing off the detailed work in operating systems, apps, and how we interact with them. This is where software development meets human-computer interaction. Two important parts of computer science, to make using our phones easy and fun. In healthcare, computer science is changing things a lot. It's key to making telemedicine platforms that let us talk to doctors from far away, and it powers advanced tools for diagnosing health issues. These changes don't just make healthcare better, they also make it easier to get and more efficient. But computer science doesn't just affect our personal lives and health. It also changes other scientific fields and industries. In science, computer models help us understand complex things like climate change or tiny molecules. The mix of computer science with other sciences leads to discoveries. In business, industries like finance, retail, and manufacturing are being transformed by data analytics, machine learning, and automation, all thanks to computer science. These technologies help companies understand big sets of data, do repetitive tasks automatically, and improve their processes. This leads to more efficiency and new ideas. At its core, computer science is about solving problems and coming up with new ideas. It uses its principles and methods to tackle tough challenges in different areas. Whether it's making new software or making existing systems better, this field is key to new solutions and tech progress. When we think about how computer science affects our daily lives, we see its impact on how common technology has become. The technology we use every day to communicate, shop online, control smart home devices, and watch streaming services all come from progress in computer science. This deep integration has made our daily activities easier and added new ways to enjoy entertainment, learn, and connect. Chapter 2A, Fundamentals of Programming. Initially, programming was a task limited to a chosen few who had to work with machine code and punch cards. This changed in the 1950s when languages like Fortran and COBOL were introduced, simplifying the programming process. Fast forward to today. We now have a wide range of programming languages available, each with its unique strength and purposes. Think of programming languages as the tools artists use to create their masterpieces. Just like painters choose between watercolor, oil, or acrylic based on their vision, programmers select the language that best suits their project's requirements. Python. Among this landscape of programming languages, Python stands out for its simplicity and elegance. These qualities have contributed greatly to its immense popularity and appeal, particularly among beginners. Created by Guido van Rossum in the 1980s, Python was designed with an emphasis on code readability and simplicity. This intentional design philosophy makes it an accessible starting point for those entering the world of programming. Python's syntax, the set of rules defining how a Python program is written and interpreted, is intentionally straightforward to read. The aim behind this design philosophy is to make the process of learning programming less daunting and more intuitive. While other programming languages may involve syntax for basic tasks, Python simplifies these procedures. Let's consider a Hello World program, the starting point for beginners. In Python, all it takes is a line. Print, Hello World. The beauty of this simplicity is not just writing less code, but also in making the code easily understood. This aspect is important for newcomers who are trying to learn the basics of programming. To fully comprehend Python and programming, you need to understand two fundamental concepts: syntax and semantics. Syntax in programming can be compared to grammar in language. It comprises the rules that govern the structure of code. In Python, this encompasses conventions such as definition, function composition, and loop structuring, which we will cover later in this chapter. On the other hand, semantics refers to the meaning conveyed by code. If syntax deals with how code functions, semantics focuses on what it accomplishes and what actions it performs. In Python, its simplicity of syntax greatly influences its semantics. The language is designed to ensure that not only does the code appear clean and legible, but also its purpose and functionality remain clear and easily understandable. Python's syntax and semantics make it a great choice for beginners. Its straightforward and concise syntax helps newcomers focus on logic and problem solving, without getting overwhelmed by syntax rules. The user-friendly nature of Python has led to its adoption in various domains, including data analysis, machine learning, web development, and scientific computing. Python's versatility demonstrates its strength as a programming language. Its rich collection of libraries and frameworks, active community support, and continuous development efforts ensure that Python remains valuable across applications and industries. Section 2. Variables. Variables play a role and are used in almost every aspect of coding. They act as the building blocks that allow programs to handle data, make decisions, and perform operations. Let's look into the concept of variables by using analogies to clarify their importance and purpose in programming. Variables are like containers or labels used for storing data in programming. Imagine a set of boxes, each labeled with a specific name. These boxes serve as storage units for items or data. Whenever you need to access that data, you simply refer to it using the label attached to the box. In programming terms, a variable functions similarly. It is a named storage location that holds data capable of changing or varying over time. For instance, let's consider an example variable called age. When you assign a value such as 30 to this variable in your program, age equals 30, it's like placing the number 30 inside a box labeled age. Then, whenever you refer to age within your program, you are essentially accessing the data, in this case 30, stored within that specific box. But variables are more than just containers. They can adapt and change their contents over time. You can modify the information contained in variables, which makes them useful tools in programming. To continue with our analogy, Think of each variable as a reusable box. You can replace the contents of the age box with a number, let's say 31. And now the variable age holds this new value. In programming, there are different types of variables designed to hold specific kinds of data. Some common types include integers. These variables store numbers. In our analogy, think of them as boxes meant for items like pebbles, where each pebble represents a number. Floats. These are used for numbers with decimal points. Imagine a box containing a mixture of sand and pebbles, where the sand represents the decimal parts of a number. Strings. Variables of this type hold text. You can imagine a box filled with letters or words. Booleans. These are true-false variables. It's similar to having a box with a light. Either the light is on, true, or off, false. Variables play an important role in coding by allowing programmers to write flexible and changing code. For example, in a program that calculates the price of items in a shopping cart, each item's price is stored in its respective variable. Let's take another example of a program that greets users. In this case, we can use a variable to store the user's name. Whenever the user enters their name, the program will retrieve the stored name from the variable. Use it in the greeting. Understanding variables is extremely important because they allow a program to interact with data. They are used for storing user inputs, controlling how a program works, and keeping track of information as it runs. Without variables, programming would be rigid and inflexible, unable to adapt or respond to inputs or situations. Variables are more than just containers for data. They add dynamism and versatility to the coding process. Let's delve deeper into the nature of variables, their scope, and how they interact within a program. Characteristics of variables. Immutable variables. In certain programming languages like Python, variables can either be mutable or immutable. This means that some variables can have their values changed while others remain fixed. For example, in Python, you can modify lists, but not strings. Immutable. The mutability or immutability of variables determines how we manipulate data stored within them throughout our program. Variable scope. The scope of a variable refers to where it's accessible within a program. Local variables are only reachable within the function they are declared in. On the other hand, global variables can be accessed from any part of the program. Understanding scope is crucial, as it dictates how and where we can use or modify its value effectively. Typecasting of variables. There are instances when we need to convert variables from one type to another. This is known as typecasting. For instance, converting a string into an integer for operations. Properly understanding how to perform typecasting is essential for accurately handling and processing data. By comprehending these aspects of variables, their mutability, immobility, scope, and typecasting, we gain an understanding of their significance in programming. Variables play a role in complex operations and data structures, going beyond simple storage of data like numbers or strings. They are instrumental in programs handling datasets where each piece of information can be stored in a variable. These variables can then be manipulated, compared, and used for calculations extracting insights or transforming data into a usable format. It's important to note that variables do not exist in isolation. They interact with one another. For instance, consider a program calculating the area of a rectangle. Two variables would typically be used to store the length and width values, while a third variable would calculate and hold the area. This showcases how variables collaborate to achieve outcomes. Effective memory management is also crucial when working with variables. When creating a variable, It occupies an allocated amount of memory to store its value. Efficient utilization of resources becomes particularly important in complex programs, where managing resources is critical. This involves understanding when to create, modify, or discard variables. Variables play a role in manipulating, storing, and retrieving data within a program. A solid understanding of variables is essential for programming proficiency, encompassing their types, scope, mutability, and interactions. They empower programmers to write efficient and impactful code that forms the foundation for more advanced programming concepts and operations. Section 3. Introduction to loops. Loops are structures within programming that allow for the repetition of a sequence of instructions until specific conditions are met. They are indispensable for carrying out tasks without resorting to writing identical code repeatedly. Let's delve into the fundamentals of loops by focusing on two used types, for loops and while loops. This exploration will help us grasp their purpose and functionality within the realm of programming. At their core, loops serve as a mechanism for repeating actions in a program. Imagine being tasked with sending invitation emails to 100 people. Performing this manually would be laborious and time-consuming. In programming, however, a loop can automate this process by completing the task with just a few lines of code. Different types of loops. For loops, when we know the exact number of times a loop needs to run, we use the for loop. It's like saying, for each person on this list, send them an invitation. This loop runs for every item in a predetermined sequence or range. In programming languages such as Python, a for loop can iterate over numbers, elements in a list, or characters in a string. Execute a block of code for each element. While loops. On the other hand, when we don't know beforehand how many times a loop should run, and it needs to continue until a specific condition is met, we use the while loop. It's like saying, as long as there are still invitations to send, keep sending them. The loop keeps running as long as the specified condition remains true. The main objective of loops is to automate tasks so that they can be done faster and with fewer chances of errors. Loops make programs more efficient, can handle tasks that would be impractical to perform manually. They form one of the structures that empower programmers to write concise, efficient, and easily understandable code. Loops go beyond repetition. They introduce the idea of control flow in programming. This entails determining which actions to repeat and under what circumstances. Grasping loops is essential for becoming proficient in programming, as they serve as the foundation for algorithms and functions in software development. Real-life application of loops in programming. Once you have a solid grasp of how loops work in programming, let's delve into their practical applications in real-life scenarios. Loops are incredibly versatile and find their use in a wide variety of situations, ranging from simple automation tasks to complex algorithms. Streamlining repetitive tasks. One common application of loops is automating repetitive tasks, which saves time and improves efficiency. For example, imagine a business that processes hundreds of customer transactions daily. It would be impractical to manually write instructions for each transaction. In such cases, loops come to the rescue by allowing us to iterate through each transaction and automatically perform necessary calculations or updates. This can involve tasks like updating account balances, generating invoices, or sending payment confirmation emails. Data processing. Loops play an essential role in data processing and analysis. Consider a data set with thousands of records, such as a list of hourly recorded temperatures. Analyzing this data manually would be an overwhelming task. However, by utilizing loops, we can automate the process of sifting through these records and perform various analytical operations like calculating averages, identifying maximum or minimum values, or extracting valuable insights from the data. Handling user interactions. In web and software development domains, loops play a crucial role in managing user interactions efficiently. For instance, a loop can be employed to generate interactive menus within a program. This loop will continuously display the menu and prompt the user for input until a specific condition is met, such as selecting the option to quit the program. This feature enhances user experience by offering a dynamic and responsive interface. Game development. In game development, loops play a vital role in continuously checking for player inputs, updating game states, and rendering graphics. This ensures an interactive and real-time experience that is crucial in modern video games. Whether it involves moving characters, responding to user commands, or updating the game environment, loops ensure that these actions are executed smoothly and seamlessly. Network and systems. Loops are also extensively utilized in network and systems administration for continuous monitoring tasks. A loop can run indefinitely, constantly checking network connection status, server health conditions, or system performance metrics. If certain thresholds are exceeded or anomalies are detected during this process, administrators can be promptly alerted. Understanding loop logic and flow control. After discussing the practical applications of loops in various real-life scenarios, it becomes essential to grasp the fundamental principles behind loop logic and flow control that make them such powerful tools in programming. Let's break down these concepts into more accessible terms. At its core, loop logic revolves around repeatedly performing actions based on specific conditions. Two main components contribute to this. The loop condition. Acting as the gatekeeper of the loop, this condition determines whether the loop should continue running or stop altogether. For example, in a while loop, it could be as straightforward as checking if a variable is less than a certain number. As long as this condition holds, the loop will keep executing. The loop body. This defines the actions that need to be repeated within the loop. It can range from simple tasks like printing messages to more intricate blocks of code involving calculations and decision-making processes. Flow control in loops. Flow control encompasses how a program progresses through a loop, deciding whether to continue or halt execution, and managing each iteration of the loop itself. Think of it as an orchestra conductor guiding the rhythm and direction of music. Let's start with the loop. The loop begins by checking a condition. If the condition is true, the program enters the loop body. Next, we execute the instructions inside the loop in a specific order. This is where the actual work of the loop takes place. After executing the loop body, we reevaluate the condition. If it's still true, we run another iteration of the loop. If not, we exit the loop and continue with the rest of our code. In some cases, we may need to break out of a loop before the condition becomes false. Many programming languages have a break statement for this purpose. It acts as an emergency exit. When used, it immediately stops the loop and moves on. To better visualize this concept, imagine a turnstile at a subway station. The turnstile represents our loop and allows one person, iteration, to pass through at a time. As long as there are people, data, or tasks, the turnstile keeps turning. When there are no more people or when it's time to close down, condition becomes false, then it stops. Understanding how loops work and how flow control is managed within them is crucial for effectively utilizing their power in programming. These concepts empower programmers to make optimized code capable of automating tasks, handling data, and efficiently managing intricate systems. Chapter 2B, Fundamentals of Programming, continued. Conditional statements, often referred to as if, else, and elif in programming languages, guide the decision-making process of a program. They allow the program to respond differently based on specific conditions or inputs. Types of conditional statements. If statement. This represents the most fundamental form of a conditional statement. It verifies a condition and executes a block of code if that condition is true. It's like saying, if it's raining, then grab an umbrella. Else statement. Frequently used alongside an if statement, the else statement offers an alternate course for the program when the if condition is not fulfilled. It's like saying, if it's raining, make sure to take an umbrella. Otherwise, you don't really need one. Elif statement. This statement, short for else if, helps us consider multiple conditions in a sequence. It's like expanding our options. If it's raining, grab an umbrella. Else, if it's snowing, put on a coat. Otherwise, just wear a light jacket. Conditional statements hold immense power when it comes to making programs dynamic and responsive. They allow programs to handle various inputs and situations by making decisions based on the data they receive. Without conditionals, programs would be rigid and incapable of adapting to changing circumstances or user inputs. In essence, conditional statements act as decision makers in the realm of programming. They bring logic and flexibility to code by enabling programs to respond differently under different conditions. This interactivity and versatility make programming more engaging and adaptable. Conditional statements in programming are similar to decision points we encounter in everyday life. They enable a program to execute certain actions based on particular conditions. If the condition is met, true, the program carries out one set of instructions. If not, it can execute an alternative set or take no action at all. Everyday examples to illustrate conditional logic. Now that we understand the role of conditional statements in programming, let's bridge the gap between code and daily life by exploring how conditional logic manifests in everyday scenarios. This approach helps in visualizing how such logic operates in a programming context. Morning routine decisions. Consider your morning routine. You might have a simple decision-making process. If it's a weekday, then prepare for work. Else, enjoy a leisurely morning. This is a practical illustration of an if-else statement. The condition here is whether or not it's a weekday, and your actions change accordingly. Choosing transportation. Imagine deciding how to commute. Your decision might follow a conditional logic. If it's raining, take the car. Elif, it's a nice day and the distance is short, ride a bike. Else, walk. This decision tree closely mirrors an if-elif-else structure, with multiple conditions leading to different outcomes. Cooking dinner. When cooking, you often use conditional logic. If I have a pasta and sauce, then make spaghetti. Else, check if I have ingredients for a salad. Here, the availability of certain ingredients dictates what you will cook, similar to how a program might decide which block of code to execute based on the availability of data. Shopping decisions. While shopping, you might think, if the item is on sale, buy two. Else, just buy one. This is a simple conditional decision based on the sales status of an item, demonstrating how everyday choices often hinge on if-then-else scenarios. Game rules. In games, conditional logic is frequently employed. If the player scores above 100 points, then advance to the next level. Else, try again. This mirrors how games use conditional statements to determine the flow of play based on players' actions and scores. The logic behind conditionals. To effectively employ conditional statements in programming, it's insightful to approach them through the lenses of why they are necessary and how they function, transcending mere syntax to grasp their practical applications. The why behind conditional statements. Conditional statements serve as the decision-making backbone of programming. They address the question, in which situations should certain actions be executed? This concept is pivotal because it empowers coders to craft dynamic and responsive code that intelligently reacts to diverse inputs and conditions. Consider a video game. Conditional statements determine if a player has enough points to level up or if an enemy reacts to the player's presence, pivotal choices that drive game mechanics and user experience. The how of executing conditional constructs. Executing conditional constructs breaks down into two primary tasks: evaluating conditions and steering the program's actions based on those assessments. Evaluating conditions. The initial step is the assessment of a condition's veracity. This critical phase requires a deep understanding of the program's data and setting precise benchmarks for decision-making. Take, for instance, an online shopping portal where conditionals assess if a user's cart exceeds a certain amount to apply a discount or qualify for free shipping. Steering program execution. Post-condition assessment. The focus shifts to navigating the program's subsequent actions. Key programming constructs like if-else and else-if statements become essential, as they route the code to perform distinct operations depending on the outcome of the condition checks. Imagine an authentication system that uses conditionals to determine if user credentials match, thereby steering the flow either toward granting access or prompting an error message. Prioritizing logic over syntax in conditionals. It's critical to look beyond the surface-level syntax of conditionals. Syntax crafts the structure, but the underlying logic breathes life into why these constructs are built. It's not solely about the creation of an if or an else clause. It's the strategic reasoning that underpins their use, anticipating the array of possible scenarios your program may encounter, and mapping out an execution path that aligns with your objectives. In conclusion, embracing both the why and the how of conditionals is about conceptualizing the scenarios, constructing a logical framework, and then implementing the syntax to manifest that logic. Chapter 2C, Fundamentals of Programming, Finale. Understanding functions in programming. In programming, a function is a self-contained module of code that accomplishes a singular task. Think of it as a mini-program within your main program that can be executed whenever you need to perform that specific task the function is designed for. Key features of functions. Reusability. This feature helps you avoid redundancy. Once a function is written, it can be invoked multiple times across the program. This approach aligns well with the DRY principle, which stands for Don't Repeat Yourself. Example: if you have an e-commerce app, instead of recalculating the total cart value each time with repetitive code, you create a function named CalculateCartTotal, which can be called whenever you need to present the total value of items in a user's shopping cart. Enhancing modularity and organization. Modularity in programming refers to the division of a software system into separate, interchangeable components, each of which contains everything necessary to execute only one aspect of the desired functionality. Example: in a customer relationship management, or CRM system, instead of having a single, monolithic set of code, you might have different functions for adding a new customer, add customer, updating customer digitals, update customer, and retrieving customer information, get customer info. Each function is self-contained and performs a distinct operation on the customer data. Params and arguments. Functions allow for adaptability through the use of parameters, sometimes known as args or arguments. These are variables that act as placeholders for values that a user or another part of the program will provide when calling the function, allowing the same function to operate on different data inputs. Example: for a function that possesses a user's payment, parameters might include the amount, currency, and user ID. This makes the function versatile for processing payments of any amount for any user. Abstraction. Abstraction is a concept where you hide the complex reality while exposing only the necessary parts. A function encapsulates specific operations within it, so the user or programmer doesn't need to know the exact details of how the function operates internally. Example: you might have a function called sendEmail. When you call sendEmail, you don't need to understand the SMTP protocols or how emails are actually sent over the internet. You just need to know what data to provide to the function for it to do its job. Testing and debugging. By isolating code into functions, you can test and debug sections of the program more easily. If something goes wrong, you can look into specific functions that may be causing the problem rather than sifting through all your source code. Example: if you have a bug in a complex operation, such as processing a user's uploaded image, having a dedicated function for image processing, process image, means you can isolate and test just this piece of the code. In essence, functions are a fundamental building block in programming that enables efficient, readable, and maintainable code development. They are both a tool for code organization and a means to encapsulate functionality for ease of use. Functions serve the purpose of simplifying the programming process by breaking down tasks into manageable pieces and avoiding unnecessary repetition. Functions as recipes. Think of a function like a recipe in a cookbook. A recipe contains instructions for preparing a specific dish. It includes specific ingredients, inputs, a defined process, instructions, and an expected outcome, the finished dish. Similarly, in programming, a function takes inputs, parameters, performs operations on them, executes the code within the function, and often produces an output, return value. For example, consider a cake recipe that lists the required ingredients, provides steps to mix and bake those ingredients, and yields the final result, a baked cake. In programming, a function to calculate the area of a rectangle would define its parameters, length and width. Specify how to perform the calculation, multiply length by width, and return the resulting area. If you've watched any videos or read any other books about functions, you may have noticed that recipes are a very common analogy for teaching about functions. This is because it is a really good example for describing functions' main concepts. Reusability. Just as you can use one recipe to make multiple dishes, you can call a function multiple times within a program. There's no need to write the entire recipe or function from scratch every time it's needed. Modularity. When it comes to cooking, a recipe helps break down the complex process into manageable steps. Similarly, in programming, a function breaks down a task into smaller and self-contained blocks of code. Clarity and organization. Just like recipes provide clear instructions to make cooking more approachable, functions help make programs easier to understand by organizing the code into logical blocks. Parameters and return values. Parameters, the pillars of flexibility in functions. Imagine stepping into a kitchen. Your ingredients are the essentials you need to create a dish. In programming, these ingredients equate to parameters, the vital inputs that a function requires to perform its task. They endow functions with the versatility to handle varied data sets, akin to tweaking a recipe to taste. Consider a simple arithmetic function designed to add two numbers. The numbers you desire to summate serve as the parameters. This setup allows you to invoke the same function repeatedly with distinct number pairs, each time churning out a unique sum. A straightforward illustration of parameters in action. Return values, the culmination of a function's process. The counterpart to parameters is the return value, which encapsulates the output of a function. After the function has diligently processed the input parameters, it is customary for it to yield a result, the return value. Reflecting on our addition function, the return value manifests as the summation of the two input numbers. Notably, certain functions execute tasks that may not necessitate returning data, similar to cooking steps that are preparatory rather than resultant. Navigating through parameters and return values. Defining parameters. Upon the inception of a function, you define what parameters it requires. This is analogous to itemizing ingredients for a dish you're about to prepare. The function utilizes these defined parameters as a blueprint to execute its operations. Passing arguments. Execution of a function is preceded by the provision of arguments, the concrete values that align with the function's parameters. Picture this as sourcing and prepping your ingredients before commencing to cook your meal. Returning a value. In the aftermath of a function's operation, it can signal completion by returning a result. This outcome is deployable across your program, much like how a well-cooked meal is ready to be served once it's off the stove. Mastering the intricacies of parameters and return values equips programmers with the ability to craft functions that are not merely autonomous, but also dynamic. Such functions excel at ingesting data, processing it with a purpose, and delivering precise results, thereby serving as indispensable instruments for problem-solving and structuring code in the vast world of programming. Section 6. Real-World Application. Let's explore how the things we've talked about in programming help us in the real world. The ideas of variables, loops, conditional statements, and functions aren't just something you learn in class. They're the secret ingredients that make all kinds of computer programs work, from games on your phone to the apps your family shops with. Here's what that looks like in real life. Programs for school or work. Think about the computer programs you use to write papers or do your math homework. They use variables to keep track of your work, loops to go through stuff, like looking for a word in your essay, conditional statements to make choices, like changing a font if you highlight text in bold, and functions to make things happen, like adding up all your numbers in a spreadsheet. Online shopping. When you buy stuff online, the website is using these programming tools to make everything happen. Variables remember your info. Loops show you all the cool stuff you can buy. Conditional statements offer you discounts at checkout. And functions take care of the important steps, like checking out securely. Apps on your phone. The games and apps you love keep track of your scores and likes with variables. Use loops to update what you see on your screen. Handle when you swipe and tap with conditional statements. And use functions to do the heavy lifting, like uploading a photo. Creating websites. Making websites is another place where programming shines. Let's break it down. Front end, what you see on the site. Loops help show stuff like a list of things you can buy. Conditional statements make menus pop up when you hover over something with your mouse. Back end, the behind-the-scenes tech part. Functions are like backstage heroes here, taking care of all your clicks and requests, like when you look something up. Variables hold on to your info for a little while, and loops help put everything in order for you to see. Understanding data. The numbers and facts that help people make decisions also depend on programming. Loops go through all the data, one piece at a time. Functions are custom-made helpers that do specific number-crunching jobs, like figuring out if something is a new trend. Making data look good. Conditional statements help decide what colors or shapes to use when showing data, so it's easy to understand. Functions are shortcuts to do the same thing with lots of different numbers without having to start from scratch every time. Science and experiments. In science, programming helps test ideas and look at what data is telling us. Loops and functions do the work when we want to simulate stuff in nature or test a science question. Variables save all the science info, and conditional statements plus loops help scientists see what's going on, like if something unusual happens. Smart robots and computers that learn. In a world where computers can learn and make decisions, like in smart robots, programming is really important. Developing these smart programs means creating special instructions, algorithms, that can learn from information and get better at making smart guesses. So there you go. Programming isn't just a bunch of rules, it's a powerful tool that helps us understand data, run websites and apps, do cool science, and even build smart robots. Chapter 3A, Introduction to Algorithms. An algorithm is a set of instructions or steps that tell a computer how to solve a problem or do a task. Just like following a recipe when cooking or the steps to solve a math problem in school, an algorithm guides a computer through different actions it needs to take to get something done. Think about making your favorite sandwich. There's a specific set of steps you follow. Choose your bread, add some spread, place the fillings, and then put the top slice on. That's an algorithm. It's a simple step-by-step guide to achieve your goal. In this case, making a delicious sandwich. Algorithms and everyday problem solving. Now that we know what an algorithm is, let's see what it's like to solve problems we face every day. Algorithms aren't just for computers. We use a similar way of thinking all the time without even realizing it. Algorithms in everyday life. Algorithms are like the steps we take to solve everyday problems. Say you're trying to figure out what to wear. You might think, if it's sunny, I'll wear shorts. If it's raining, I'll wear a raincoat. That's you using a simple algorithm to make a decision based on what the weather's like. Real-world example, organizing a bookshelf. Imagine you have a bunch of books to put on a shelf, and you want to arrange them alphabetically. You go through each book, find its place based on the letter it starts with, and put it there. You're following a set of steps, an algorithm, to organize your books. Technology example, online search engines. Let's take this into the tech world. Think about when you search for something on the internet. Search engines like Google use complex algorithms to decide which results to show you first. They look at what you typed, compare it to millions of web pages, and then show you the ones they think are the most helpful for your search. The future of algorithms. Looking ahead, algorithms are getting even smarter. In the future, they might help us do things like reducing traffic jams by telling cars the best routes to take, or even helping doctors diagnose illnesses more accurately by analyzing patients' symptoms and medical records. The importance of algorithms in computer science and daily life. In the world of computers, algorithms are like the secret sauce that makes everything work. They're the step-by-step instructions that tell computers how to do all sorts of cool stuff, from showing you your friends' new posts on social media to playing your favorite video games. Real-world example, cooking a meal. Let's think about cooking your favorite meal. You follow a recipe. That recipe is an algorithm. It tells you what ingredients you need, what steps to take, and in what order so you end up with something yummy to eat. With the recipe, it'd be easier to get your meal just right. Technology example, streaming services. Now let's look at something techie, like Netflix or Spotify. These streaming services use algorithms to figure out what movies or songs you might like. They look at what you've watched or listened to before and suggest new stuff they think you'll enjoy. It's like having a super smart friend who always knows what you're in the mood for. Future of algorithms. Looking into the future, algorithms are going to be even more important. They might help us solve big problems, like figuring out how to make cars and trucks run without polluting the air or helping farmers grow more food to feed more people. Section 2. Characteristics of algorithms. Key characteristics: clarity, efficiency, effectiveness. Let's dive into what makes a good algorithm. Just like a recipe, a good algorithm has certain qualities that make it stand out: clarity, efficiency, and effectiveness. Understanding these qualities helps us appreciate why some algorithms work better than others. Clarity. Clarity in an algorithm is like having clear instructions when putting together a toy model. It means the steps in the algorithm are easy to understand and follow. No one likes confusing instructions. The same goes for algorithms. They should be straightforward so that anyone, or any computer, can follow them without getting mixed up. Efficiency. Efficiency in an algorithm is all about doing the task well without wasting time or resources. Think of it like a smart route that gets you to school the fastest. An efficient algorithm solves a problem quickly and only makes the computer do what it needs to do. It's important because we don't want our computers or apps to be slow. We want them to give us answers fast. Effectiveness. Effectiveness is about getting the right result every time. Imagine you have a recipe for your favorite cookie. If every time you follow it, you get delicious cookies, that recipe is effective. The same goes for algorithms. They need to give the correct answer or result every time they're used. Conclusion on clarity, efficiency, and effectiveness. So, a great algorithm should be clear or easy to understand, efficient, fast and doesn't waste resources, and effective, always works right. These qualities make sure that the algorithm does its job well, just like a good recipe guarantees great cookies. Introduction to the concept of algorithmic efficiency. Now that we've talked about the key characteristics of algorithms, let's zoom in on one of them: efficiency. Algorithmic efficiency is super important because it's all about how fast and smartly an algorithm can get something done. What is algorithmic efficiency? Think about it when you do your homework. If you have a quick and smart way to get it done, you have more time to play or hang out with friends. That's what efficiency is about in algorithms, too. It's finding the best way to solve a problem so that a computer doesn't take too long or use too much power or memory. Why does efficiency matter? Efficiency matters because computers, even though they're really fast and powerful, have limits. An algorithm needs to be more efficient to make a computer run slow, take up too much space, or even be able to solve the problem at all if it's really big or complicated. Measuring efficiency. When computer scientists talk about efficiency, they often think about two things: time and space. Time is about how long it takes for an algorithm to finish its job. Space is about how much memory it takes up in the computer while it's working. A super efficient algorithm uses less time and space. Understanding and improving algorithmic efficiency is like figuring out the fastest and smartest way to do your homework. It's about making algorithms quick and light so computers can solve problems easily without getting bogged down. Real-life analogies to explain algorithm characteristics. For the final part of this section, let's use some everyday examples to really understand how the characteristics of algorithms, clarity, efficiency, and effectiveness, play out in real-life and future technology. Real-life analogy: a road trip. Imagine you're planning a road trip. It would help if you had a clear plan, clarity. You wanted to get there without wasting too much time or gas, efficiency. And you definitely wanted to end up at the right destination, effectiveness. Clarity. Just like you need clear directions for your road trip, an algorithm needs to have clear steps. If the directions need to be clearer, you might take wrong turns.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.